grateful to turn our attention now to God's Word as we've prepared our hearts in worship. And I think the lyrics of that song, the first time I heard it was this morning, and thinking about this incredible thing that's waiting for us, this incredible place that's given to us, that this new Jerusalem that Jesus Christ is preparing for each one of us is awaiting us. And I think I can't help but thinking about that without recognizing how utterly undeserving we are of that. And I think that, you know, in the summer, there's always a lot of movies that are out, and I don't know if you've been to some movies, but one of these themes that continues to come through a lot of stories in our culture is this story of the undeserving person, the sort of rags to riches sort of story, the person who is not deserving of the item, the riches that are coming to that person or the stature. We love these stories from Frodo Baggins and Jane Eyre and Annie and Rudy, which is one of my favorites. Spider-Man, even, he's this neighborhood guy. Pretty Woman, Mr. Deeds. Actually, every Adam Sandler movie ever made, I think, is that sort of thing. But we love this, and I think the reason that we love these types of stories is because we recognize that we are ordinary people undeserving of any kindness or riches that would come towards us. And we're going to look at God's Word today at a story, an account of a person who recognizes that God's kindness isn't deserved for them. But yet God lavishes His kindness upon us because of Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful and just floored by the fact that You would give us Your kindness and Your grace and Your love, that You would choose to set it upon us. We recognize daily, maybe hourly, that we are undeserving of Your favor, and yet You give it to us in extravagant measure. God, would we grasp that in a greater way today to give You greater glory and to live in greater freedom for all that Jesus Christ has done for us, we pray in His name. Amen. Well, go ahead and grab your Bibles, turn over to 2 Samuel chapter 9. We are continuing in our series Unsung. This is the second to last week in our series Unsung, where we're looking at the lives of ordinary people. Many of them, we don't even know their names, and today is one that hopefully by the end you'll be able to pronounce the guy's name. But these are stories of people who are unsung heroes of the faith. Today we're going to be talking about, ready? Mephibosheth. I've been practicing all week. Mephibosheth is his name. Easy to say. You could call him Phoebe or Emmy or whatever you want, but we're going to go with Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth is a hero of the faith, not because of what he did, but because of what he received, the great abundance that he received that was so disproportionate to who he is, and the grace and the abundance and the kindness that I receive that's so disproportionate to who I am. Let's read 2 Samuel 9. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 8 at this time. And David said, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul that I may show kindness to him for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba, and they called him to David. And the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" And he said, "I am your servant." And the king said, "Is there not still someone of the house of Saul that I may show kindness of God to him?" Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in his feet." The king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "He is in the house of Machir, the son of Emiel, at Lo Debar." Then King David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Emiel, at Lo Debar. And Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David and fell on his face and paid homage. And David said, "Mephibosheth." And he answered, "Behold, I am your servant." And David said to him, "Do not fear, for I will show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan, and I will restore to you all the land of Saul your father, and you shall eat at my table always." And he paid homage and said, "What is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I?" You see, God's rescuing kindness is abundantly, immeasurably more than all that we could ask or imagine because of Jesus Christ. As we look at the kindness of God today, it is first available to me no matter where I am. God's kindness is available to me no matter where I am. Now, you see here that David is looking for somebody to show kindness to. He actually says, "Is there still anyone left of the house of Saul?" David's looking for this person to show kindness to. Why? For Jonathan's sake. Now, a little bit of a history lesson, if you don't remember your Bible. Saul, first king of Israel ever. First king. Now, Saul doesn't do great, has a lot of problems, and because of his sin, God comes to Saul through the prophet and says, "You're not going to be king anymore, and your kids, they're not going to be king. I'm picking somebody else." And there's this really cool interchange where David is the one who's chosen. He's a shepherd and a musician. So John, wherever you went, you've got a good chance at king here. You've got musicians. So David, later he becomes this incredible warrior. We know the story of Goliath and all of those kinds of things. So David, God says to David, "You're going to be the king, not Saul anymore." Now Saul has a son named Jonathan, who is a great warrior. He's a military leader, lots of conquests. He's a great archer, except there's this account where he like misses the target by a mile, and that's a whole other story. But anyway, so David and Jonathan are best friends. Now, this gets a little tricky because Jonathan's dad, whose name is Saul, is trying to kill David because Saul knows that the kingdom is leaving his household and it's going to David. And so he begins to be jealous, and they come up with these songs about Saul has killed his thousands, David's killed his 10,000s, and Saul throws a javelin at him. There's all this it's crazy. It's like something out of Maury, you know? So all this crazy stuff happens. But in the midst of all of that, David and Jonathan become best friends. So much so that they form a covenant together. Like, we're in this no matter what. I know my dad wants to kill you, but man, it's me and you. I'm committed to you. I'm loyal to you. And no matter what happens, we're in this together. So David and Jonathan have this covenant together. And so here, this is later. We'll talk about it in a minute. But Jonathan and Saul are both dead. And here's David, who's become the king of Israel. And now he's saying, "I want to, because of my commitment to Jonathan, because of the covenant that I made with him, I'm looking for somebody to show kindness to." That's where we jump in here. Now, kindness, this isn't niceness. This isn't letting somebody merge in traffic. This isn't giving up your seat on the red line at like 8:25 in the morning on a Tuesday. You've been there. This isn't like, "Oh, you can sit down." It's not the go ahead. It's not the have the last piece of pizza. It's not kindness. The word is, you may have heard this before, the word is hesed, which is covenant, loyal love. It's based on a promise. It's, "I'm not breaking this promise." It's not letting somebody go. It's not being easy like that. It's an intentional decision to show kindness, even or maybe especially when that kindness is undeserved. And David is looking for somebody to show this kind of covenant loyal love, this kindness of God, as he calls it. He's looking for that person because of his relationship with Jonathan. And here he hears about son of Jonathan, whose name is Mephibosheth. Now, Mephibosheth isn't around when David's looking for this person. This guy was from a royal line, and he's not even in the city. He's actually in this place. He's at this guy's house in a town called Lo Debar. Now, Lo Debar is east of the Jordan River. At that time, it was like outside of Israel almost. It's like out in the wilderness. Lo Debar literally means nothing or desolate place. So think about that for a minute. The son of the first king of Israel is living in desolation, away from God's chosen place with God's chosen people. He is at a place called desolate, or no pasture, no place at all. Have you ever found yourself in a place that you would just describe as desolate? How you doing today? Desolate. That's how I'm feeling today. Maybe your career isn't what you had hoped for. Maybe you're single, but you're not satisfied. Maybe you're in a relationship, but it's broken and you don't see a way to mend that. Maybe your finances are in shambles. Maybe my health is failing and I don't have a fix. Maybe you're alone and isolated, feeling forgotten by friends, and maybe even worse, feeling forgotten by the Lord. That's where Mephibosheth was, desolate in Lo-Debar. He's east of the Jordan, running from his life. And the reason he is, if you look back to 2 Samuel 4:4, you don't have to turn there now. It says, Jonathan, the son of Saul, had a son who was crippled in his feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel. And his nurse took him up and fled. And as she fled in her haste, he fell and became lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. So there's this fateful day when Saul and Jonathan are both killed in a battle that Saul wasn't supposed to be in anyway. And as they're killed, can you see this? The nurse, the person taking care of Mephibosheth, this little five-year-old boy, picks him up and is running out of Jerusalem to escape the city and drops him somehow. And somehow he's injured in his feet for his entire life. I don't know what kind of injury it was. It doesn't tell us. But he seemed to be walking fine before that day. Here he is likely in his 20s or 30s. It says that he has a young son. He's probably in his 20s or 30s. He still can't walk well because of that injury that happened to him. Every day as he moves around with great difficulty, he feels in his feet the reminder of the day when his father and his grandfather were killed. The reminder of what could have been. I should have been king. But then I was dropped by somebody. And now I'm fleeing for my life, for my entire life. And I'm not even able to walk on my own. Living in exile, every day reminded that instead of becoming a king, he became severely injured and in exile. I wonder what his life was like in the wilderness. I wonder what he went about. We see a little bit later how he views himself as a dead dog. Really briefly, here's three things to do when I'm in the wilderness. When I'm feeling alone, when I'm feeling like God has forgotten me, when I'm feeling like my friends and my family have left me to die in this desolate place, when I'm feeling like I don't have the answers to go forward and everything is dark, here's what to do in the wilderness. First, don't isolate yourself. Our natural inclination is to shut down relationships when we're in that wilderness place, to feel like, 1, 2, 3 people let me down. No one cares about me. Yes, he was injured. Yes, someone failed him who should have been taking care of him. But running into exile and fleeing into darkness and isolating yourself will never get you to a good place. So even though the enemy says, you're on your own, nobody cares, rush to community. Maybe somebody needs to join a small group today because of that. Get into relationships. Press in. Don't isolate yourselves. Secondly, right size your circumstance. We think it's too big. It's too hard. It's too long. I can't get past this. God is unconcerned. Maybe God can't even help me at this point. I don't see a path out. Listen, God is in control. And God genuinely cares about the things that you are going through and the things that I am going through. And don't allow your circumstance to crowd out the greatness of God. That no matter how dark it is, there is a path forward. You may not see it, but God holds it in his hand. Right size your circumstance. And then thirdly, look for God. He's looking for you. Look at what David is doing here. Mephibosheth is out in the wilderness in Lo-Debar. He's in desolation. And here's David, the king. He's looking for him. Where did he go? I got to find this guy. He's looking for them. God is looking to show kindness to us. And so David sends for Mephibosheth here. Now, what do you think Mephibosheth is feeling here? We see that he tells Ziba what he's going to do. As far as we can tell, Mephibosheth isn't told what's going to happen to him when he comes to Jerusalem. Maybe he is, but I think by his reaction, he doesn't have any clue what's happening. He just knows King David, the guy my grandfather was trying to kill, and now he's the king, he's calling for me. Because likely in that day, the king, the new king who would come in, would kill everyone of the line of the old king to ensure that there wouldn't be some kind of coup, to ensure that this person's not going to come back and try to claim the throne later. So I think Mephibosheth has a pretty good reason to be afraid here as he's coming into David's presence, being called to the king. I imagine him thinking, like, how much worse could my life get? Man, I've been running since I was 5 years old. I can barely move around, and now I'm getting called to... He's probably going to put me to death on the spot. What is this going to be like? Just this downward spiral of fear and anxiety. And maybe you feel, as you're in that desolate place, like it just keeps getting worse. Can I catch a break? We've had ongoing car issues, which I wouldn't call desolation, but for like... feels like the last 20 years. I've been posting on Instagram like car cursed and things like that. We finally bought a new, I mean, it's not a new car, it's an 06, so let's get realistic. But like, we finally got a car that I think is going to run really well. But I just, for a long time, I felt like no matter what car I touch, it's going to die. I'm going to shell out thousands of dollars into the car and then it will die, because that's what was happening. And I finally decided, like, we're going to get the best car we can for the best price, and I'm just going to pray that it, so pray for my car, that it doesn't die. But where I can see, that's just a silly little illustration about a car. But if you're in something deeper and darker, a relationship that's broken, a prodigal child, a health concern that you don't see the out of, a career that's just, I can't see where I'm going, it's very, very easy for us to get to that place where it's like, it's never going to get better. It's going to keep getting worse. What now? What now? And that's where Mephibosheth finds himself. He's in this desolate place. Maybe you feel like it's based on your choices of the past. Man, I just made some really bad decisions and I'm dealing with all the consequences now. Maybe you feel like it's, I didn't even do anything. The person who was supposed to be taking care of me dropped me and now I'm injured because of that. But wherever you are, even in that desolate place, God's kindness is available to you today. David is looking to show kindness. God is looking for those he would show his kindness to us. And his kindness is available to you no matter where you are. And the kindness of God, it reaches me regardless of who I am. Regardless of who I am. Notice in verse 3, when Ziba tells King David about Mephibosheth, he says, there is still a son of Jonathan, he is crippled in his feet. Ziba doesn't even use his name. He just defines the guy by the injury that he has. And the enemy would walk around time and time again, broken, sinful, lost, a mess, would identify us and label us by the tragedy that happened in the past. You don't have to carry that anymore. You're not known by your past. You're not known by the past that was done to you or the past that you chose to do. Jesus Christ washes that clean and changes us today. And regardless of where we are, God's kindness reaches us. Think about Mephibosheth for a minute. His grandfather is the first king of Israel. Scripture says that he was a head above all the other men. It's kind of like me. No, really. I joke with my wife all the time. I'm really tall. I'm 5'9". I would like to be tall like Scott someday. Someday maybe I can. I don't know. But his grandfather is the first king. The guy who, when people would look at Saul, they'd be like, now there's a king. That's the guy we want to lead us. David, by contrast, you know, when Samuel does the, like, picking of the king, David's not even there. He's not even at the ceremony. He's out in the field because his dad's like, oh, that guy? No way he's a king. Even his dad is like, he's not a king. Samuel waits. Eventually, he is decided that he's going to be the king. But so Scripture says that Saul is like that. He's this guy that everybody was like, oh my gosh, that guy's the king. That's what a king is like. And then Jonathan, who's this incredible military warrior, he's a commander of thousands of troops and wins these incredible victories. And here's Mephibosheth in a place called Lo-Debar, which means desolate. Mephibosheth's actual name literally means from the mouth of shame. So he's walking around in a place of desolation, feeling deep shame about his past, thinking about all of the things that could have been. An outcast separated from his people he had hoped to lead. Can you imagine him growing up like, man, I should have been the king over all this. And here I am, I don't even get to be in the land of my people anymore. I'm running for my life. I can't even walk. My whole family's dead. Just feeling like he's an outcast. Mephibosheth comes, he thinks he's going to be killed as he falls down before King David. But what he doesn't know is David is for him. Mephibosheth feels like an enemy. He sees himself as an enemy, as an outcast who's injured, but what does David see? David sees his best friend's kid. Can you hear? Just all he says to him, Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David, fell on his face, and paid homage. Can you just see David here? And David says, Mephibosheth! He's like so excited to see the guy. This is my best friend's kid. I haven't seen him since he was 5. He's in his 30s now. He's like, oh my goodness, look how big you are. I can't even believe it. Oh my gosh. He's so excited. He sees his best friend's kid here. Mephibosheth recognizes that he doesn't deserve his kindness, so much so that he says, what is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I? But David is set on reaching him with his kindness. Listen, your place and your past do not determine your future. God's kindness reaches through the brokenness. It reaches through the desolation. It reaches through the shame. It reaches through your pain. While the world would call you broken, God calls you restored. While the world calls you lost, God calls you found. While the world calls you slave, God calls you free. While the world calls you outcast, God calls you redeemed. While the world calls you shame, God says you're a son. While the world says you're desolate, God calls you a daughter. While the world calls you an enemy, God calls you family. And his kindness reaches to each one of us, regardless of where we are and regardless of who we are. God's kindness reaches us. And God's kindness is extravagant towards me because of who he is. God's kindness is extravagant towards me because of who he is. 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 9. Then the king called Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, all that belonged to Saul and to all his house I have given to your master's grandson. And you and your sons and your servants shall till the land for him and shall bring in the produce that your master's grandson may have bread to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's grandson, shall always eat at my table. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, according to all that my lord the king commands his servant, so will your servant do. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah, and all who lived in Ziba's house became Mephibosheth's servants. So Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, for he ate always at the king's table. Now he was lame in both his feet. Look, he eats at the king's table always like one of his sons. He's brought in to be family. David's kindness to Mephibosheth is so extravagant. Not just, hey, you're not going to die. I'm not killing you. But come and sit at my table forever. And then, hey, this guy who used to serve your grandfather Saul, this guy Ziba, he's got all these people who work for him, and he's got all these sons. Well, guess what? They're all your servants now. They're going to work the land for you. They're going to provide for you. They're going to take care of you. Calls Ziba there, and he's like, hey, take care of this guy. And Ziba is given to Mephibosheth as a servant. It's extravagant. This extravagant rescue that Mephibosheth receives, it's not because of who he is. It's because of who David is and the commitment that David made with his father, Jonathan. Look at verse 7. I will show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan. Listen, even before you were born, there was a covenant made with you in mind. It's based on this covenant. You didn't design it. You didn't create it. You can't lose it. But it's for you. And God's kindness is given to me because of Jesus Christ. At that Last Supper, he said, this is the blood of the, what? Anybody remember this? Of the new covenant. That's what Jesus' death is accomplishing for us. It's a covenant made before you were born with you in mind, that his kindness can rush to us wherever we are and whoever we are to forgive us of our sins. We have this chart that I hope will help explain some things here. So David says, is there anyone left of the house of Saul that I can show kindness to for the sake of Jonathan? And that's Mephibosheth. The covenant that was made before Mephibosheth was ever born extends to him because of Jonathan. I'm sorry, the arrow is the wrong way. That's my fault. I sent it to our comms team with bad handwriting. So David's covenant with Jonathan extends to Mephibosheth. It's not based on who he was or what he did or where he was. It's based on the covenant that was already there. Just imagine what God would say in this other diagram. That God would say, is there anyone left of the house of Adam that I can show kindness to for the sake of Jesus Christ? Because of what Jesus did, the new covenant that's made in his blood. And that's us. The covenant made by Jesus Christ, his death on the cross, that if we turn from our sins and embrace Jesus Christ by faith, we receive all of the blessings of that covenant. We're restored. We're given everything that was promised to Jesus Christ, that he gives us this new Jerusalem that we sang about earlier. Here's three things. God's kindness means, first, no fear. Look in verse 7. David says very briefly, do not fear. Listen, fear is a natural response when we recognize how undeserving we are to even be in the presence of the king. But God says in 1 John 4:18 that perfect love casts out all fear. And while we have a holy reverence for a holy God, his perfect love casts out our fear that would drive us into exile, that would drive us to run from him, that would drive us to isolate ourselves. This perfect love, says his love brings you to repentance. And that's what it does. It brings us close. God's kindness means no fear. God's kindness means restoration. When Mephibosheth looked in the mirror, all he saw was that reminder of the day when his father and his grandfather were killed. All he saw was his inability to walk correctly. All he saw was all that he lacked. All he saw was what could have been, but is now missing. And maybe when you look in the mirror, that's what you see. I see my failures. I'm haunted by the choices of my past. I wish I would have done that differently. All you see is a reminder of your shortcomings, your failures, your inability, your sins. But God's kindness to you means that you are restored. Look at what happens with Mephibosheth. He restores all of the house of Saul to Mephibosheth. So if you've turned from your sins and embraced Jesus Christ by faith, you are washed clean. You are forgiven of your past. You are restored to a right relationship with God because of Jesus Christ. And then thirdly, God's kindness means a place at the table. A place at the table. It's repeated four times through here. Verse 7, verse 10, verse 11, verse 13. A place at the table, a place at the king's table. What's so crazy here is this isn't like at the kids' table, like when you go to Thanksgiving and you got to sit at the little folding table at the end. You don't even get like a real chair. You're like sitting on this goofy little stool. It's not the kids' table. You're at the king's table. And notice it's not at a table. It's at my table. A table is a picture of provision. All of Mephibosheth's needs will be provided for. He has a servant now. He's going to even help him for these things. And then he's coming to the table daily to eat at the king's provision. A table is a picture of provision. The table is a picture of abundance. Do you think? Picture in your head, like a king's table sitting there. Do you think that they were ever short on food? They ever run out at the king's table? No, of course not. It's like, man, get out the Tupperware again. Where are we going to put all this stuff? We got to buy a new fridge. We got to put all these leftovers in there. It's abundance. It never runs out. It's at the king's table. But the table is also a picture of intimacy. It wasn't just come sit at a table. It wasn't just, I'm going to give you a gift card for a restaurant. It was, come sit at my table. Sit next to me. I want you near me. I want a relationship with you. Can you see David there, sitting next to Mephibosheth? I mean, think about this. It's his best friend. It's his son. He hasn't seen his best friend in years. He was killed a long time ago. Mephibosheth was 5 when his father was killed. Can you see him sitting there like, oh, let me tell you some of the crazy stories that me and your dad got into. Man, he was quite an archer. You know, you have your dad's eyes. Can you see him there? He wants a relationship with Mephibosheth. Not just provision. Not even just abundance, but intimacy. That I want you in relationship with me. God would call us into that relationship and would say, all that stuff in the past, that's fine. I just want to get to know you more. I want to grow this relationship. That's what David is looking for. I wonder what that first dinner would have looked like when Mephibosheth was there. Picture all the king's sons kind of sitting around, his officials. They're all sitting there. David's standing at the end of the table. We're waiting. There's Mephibosheth, who has an injury in his feet. Probably new to the palace. Maybe he doesn't know where the dining room is yet. See him taking his time to try to get there. Like, oh, I can't be late for dinner. David's standing there. We're waiting. We're waiting till he gets here. No one eats until Mephibosheth is. Because I'm showing my kindness to him. Not because of where he was. Not because of who he is, but because of who I am. And God would wait for each one of us to declare over you that his kindness reigns extravagantly upon you. Would you bow your heads in prayer for a moment? God is patient. God is waiting for us. He's looking for someone to show his kindness to. Maybe you've never yet turned from your sins and trusted Jesus Christ by faith. Maybe you've never received God's kindness. Today could be that day for you. And maybe like many of us, you find yourself in a place of desolation. You find yourself in Lodabar. It's not great out here. I'm in the wilderness. I'm believing the lies of the enemy. I'm believing the lies of the people around me. I'm believing the lies of myself that say I'm not worthy. That say there's nothing for me. That say I should be marked by my past sins and my failures and what's been done to me. That I should be labeled by those things. but God's kindness reaches to us. So I want to open up the front of the church. I'm not going to make you say anything. I want the opportunity to pray for you. If you feel like you're in Lodabar today, if you feel like you're in that place of desolation, I need a fresh experience of God's kindness. There's nothing special about the front of the church, but let your walking to the front and kneeling and bowing here be a statement to the Lord. He is looking for somebody to show kindness to. And it would rush to you today. So come now as we sing, and I'm going to pray over us in one moment. The kindness of God can be received by each one of us in an extravagant measure. So come now as we sing.